So Jesus had compassion for the crowds because they were harassed and helpless, like those without someone to lead them. Like the crowds in the text, we are harassed and helpless as well. And God has compassion for us too. Compassion, as defined by Merriam-Webster, is the sympathetic awareness of other people's distress, connected with a desire to alleviate it. A friend of mine defines it more simply as suffering with another. But she also differentiates it from empathy. Oftentimes, empathy gets equated with compassion. It is even a synonym, according to Microsoft. Empathy is feeling. Toward action to alleviate the suffering or the distress. Compassion is a non-judgmental emotion that we practice to ease pain and to show genuine love for one another. Now, the first thing that stood out to me when I read this passage was Jesus had compassion for the crowds because they were harassed and helpless. The crowds gathering around Jesus and those that he saw everywhere he went were harassed and helpless. The power of this description is that the crowds found that love and compassion that was given. They were at the end of their ropes, struggling to make ends meet, frustrated with the political environment, and not knowing what to do. This doesn't sound all too different from many of us 2,000 years later. Just like the crowd which Jesus was watching, I imagine many of you may feel harassed and helpless. There may be the newly married couple trying to figure out how to live in a new life together, possibly struggling to make ends meet. The young parents at their wits' end, feeling ill-equipped for the all-encompassing role that is before them. The parents with older children who are rebelling, and you don't know how to respond to keep those kids safe from harm and from their own poor choices. The married couple facing separation or divorce. Many are feeling harassed and helpless in this uncertain economy and in lost jobs. There is also the unknown health environment in which we find ourselves living, not knowing what will happen. You may feel harassed and helpless as you cope with the death of a loved one, with the relationships that you have that may not be all that you wished for them to be. Those who feel they are dismissed because of age, gender, ethnicity, or sexual orientation may feel harassed and helpless. This is shown so clearly by all the many protests that people have been offering because they have felt harassed and helpless for centuries. They've suffered inequality and persecution for hundreds of years. Many who have recently graduated from high school or college with no clear future or job prospects before them may feel harassed and helpless. While on the opposite end of the spectrum, there are those who are recently retired, or maybe not so recently, and who have wonder if they have any value or purpose beyond the former career. If we're honest, we feel harassed and helpless more than we may realize. It's important to understand that feeling harassed and helpless is not a sign of failure. It is a sign of being human. All of these situations allow us to offer compassion and God's love to the people in our lives. Now, as is my usual, I started thinking about which movie clip I might use as an illustration for compassion to go along with this sermon, because there are just so many options. Compassion is so important that even Hollywood realizes that it's a topic for discussion. There are There's the Beauty and the Beast, both versions, Hotel Rwanda, pretty much every Star Wars movie, Lord of the Rings, The Hobbit, Transformers, Up, How to Train Your Dragon, and Just Mercy. But I decided that I was going to share just two scenes from a different movie called Seabiscuit. Now, if you haven't seen it, it's a movie that's loosely based on the real life story of the horse who raced during the Great Depression. Now, the first scene shows Charles Howard, who later becomes the owner of Seabiscuit, and he is speaking with Tom Smith. Howard is asking Smith about a different horse who has been injured, and Howard asks, "Will he race again?" And Smith says, "No." Then Howard replies, "Then why are you fixing him?" And Smith replies, "Because I can. Every horse is good for something. He could be a cart horse or a lead pony. And he's still nice to look at. And you don't throw a whole life away just because he's banged up a little." Smith had saved that horse from being shot just because his foot was injured. Smith knew that even broken, that horse still had value, and he had compassion, and he acted upon it. Later on, that same line is used in reference to someone else. You don't throw a whole life away just because a person gets banged up a little. All of us get hurt in life, and we all deserve compassion. Now, the second scene from the movie that caught my attention was when they started showing different pictures from the Great Depression of people who were at soup kitchens or after they had lost their jobs and their homes, and others who were in dire straits because of the situation in which they found themselves. The narrator, as these pictures are cycling through, says they called it relief, but it was a lot more than that. It had dozens of names, NRA, WPA, the CCC, but it really came down to just one thing. For the first time in a long time, someone cared. For the first time in a long time, you were no longer alone. So those last two phrases really caught my attention. Someone cared, and you were no longer alone. The despair and heartache and loneliness that the majority of the country felt during the Depression was lightened because of compassion. Now, when we help one another, we improve the situation for more than just that person. And it comes through simply showing care and helping people not to feel alone, helping them to feel valued and worthy. Jesus sees us and has compassion. Jesus did not come primarily to teach or to inspire. We can find plenty of inspiration from the motivational section in the bookstore or from the plethora of internet memes that are out there giving us those inspirational thoughts. Jesus offers us way more than that. Jesus came out of the abundant compassion and love which God has for the world. And Jesus came in order to demonstrate that loving compassion through word and deed, calling us to do the same. And when we realize our state of being harassed and helpless people, we can move away from there. This realization opens us up to being transformed by God's loving response. Our culture exerts pressure upon us, pressure to seemingly have it all together, to be perfect, to have the ideal life and job and family. This pressure is quietly crushing the spirit within many of us. But God has compassion for us. God tells us that through Jesus we are loved exactly as we are. We don't have to have it all together or lead the perfect life, whatever that may be. Jesus didn't come for perfect people. And he doesn't expect us to be perfect. It's okay to feel harassed and helpless. In fact, that is why God sent Jesus, to tell us that God loves us, especially in these moments when we feel harassed and helpless. God loves us, not the person that we're trying to be or that we have promised to be or even who we want to be. God loves us as we are. Even as harassed and helpless and imperfect as we are, God loves us and God calls us to share that love with others. No matter who you are, God has acted in our lives through other people. So even if you aren't feeling alone and helpless and imperfect at this time, you can show God's love to others. God can work through you to help someone else who is feeling harassed and helpless. Now, Jesus also said in our text, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. There is always plenty of work to do in showing God's love to the world. And it seems like there are fewer and fewer of us that do so. As we hear of more violence throughout the country and even the world, it's ever more evident and important for us to show God's love to everyone, to show God's love for all those who are feeling harassed and helpless, to show God's love for those who need a kind word or a loving smile, to just show God's love. But in these days, we are also called to step up, to help those being cast out and downtrodden, to speak up about the injustices around us. Now, I realize that you may not agree with the Black Lives Matter movement, but I ask you to acknowledge that persecution and inequality still exist for people of color. This coming Wednesday is the 5th anniversary of the killing of the Emmanuel Nine, a day when a young man who happened to be an ELCA Lutheran walked into a Bible study in Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in Charleston, South Carolina, and he killed 9 people. That was 5 years ago, and here we are, racism is still as prevalent. Now, I forgot to mention that we have these 9 plants over on the table that are in memory of the Emmanuel 9, and we will have a litany for them here during our prayers. But our world needs the compassion that Jesus has shown us and that God gives to each and every one of us. Our calling is to help each other, to show compassion, to share God's love, because God loves us just as we are. And thank God for that. Amen.